So to fully activate a B cell, we need a number of signals. The first signal obviously comes from the B cell receptor, and it binds with its antigen binding sites, and the B cell receptor moves closer together, B cell receptor cross-linking, resulting in phosphorylation of the ITAMs, and you have a signal sent into the nucleus. That's the first signal you need. The second one, which we covered previously, was engagement of the B cell co-receptor, which is binding complement on the surface of the pathogen. So it turns out there's one more signal that's needed in order to fully activate the B cell. And there are two different ways to get this signal, and they're going to lead to two different results. So one way, and the reason that we need all these signals, is the B cell really wants to be sure that it is recognizing something that is foreign to the body, that is non-self. So it really likes confirmation, more and more confirmation. So the final piece of confirmation a B cell could get is engagement of the toll-like receptors. So if you remember TLRs, toll-like receptors, they bind a variety of substances that are not found on human cells, but found in viruses or bacteria. So B cells have toll-like receptors, specifically TLR 10, 7, 9, for example. And if those TLRs engage their ligand, for example, TLR7 binds RNA, viral RNA, TLR9 binds bacterial or viral DNA. So if they engage their ligand, then that B cell can be pretty certain that whatever it's recognizing, it's covered in complement, and it's definitely a foreign substance. This B cell is pretty sure it can unleash an attack, and so it does. This B cell can finally undergo clonal expansion, lots of mitosis, and you get plasma cells that produce IgM. And this IgM is secreted and can attack the pathogen the way IgM does, via activating the classical pathway of complement. So this is called thymus-independent activation, because this whole process didn't require T cells. T cells are generated in the thymus, and this process didn't require the T cells, so it doesn't technically require the thymus. That's why it's called thymus independent. So some antigens that provoke an immune response are called TI antigens, thymus independent antigens. The B cell was able to basically check itself, give permission to itself using its own receptors, and didn't need any help from T cells. That's a thymus independent response. You'll notice the response only produced IgM. And we didn't see any isotype switching, any affinity maturation, and that's because those events don't occur when thymus-independent antigens produce antibodies. It is possible that the B cell could actually ask for help, confirmation that this is in fact a pathogen. And so what a B cell can do, and we'll see in a later video, is contact a helper T cell, also known as a CD4 positive T cell, also known as a TFH cell, right? TFT for follicular helper cell. So if this B cell, and we'll see in a later video, in the next video, if the B cell checks with the T cell and says, hey, this thing that I'm recognizing, do you think that it's also not belonging in the body? And the T cell says, yes, I can confirm that it doesn't belong here. The T cell will communicate with the B cell via cytokines and other proteins. That will allow this B cell to undergo mitosis, but also trigger the processes of affinity maturation and isotype switching. So with help from the T cell, you actually get a much more robust response. You get switched to different types of antibodies that might be better suited to fight this infection or neutralize the infection or opsonize. You're also going to make, you make plasma cells that secrete, you make memory cells that remember the infection for years. This is a high affinity antibody because it underwent somatic hypermutation and isotype switching. So all of this occurred with the B cell communicating with a helper T cell. So this is a thymus dependent response. So B cells can activate independently. That would be a thymus independent response. Or B cells can activate with the help of T cells. That's a thymus-dependent response. And that's going to be much better in terms of fighting the pathogen, because it involves making much better antibodies in terms of they have higher affinity and their isotype switched. And it produces lifelong memory. So this video just covers the difference between TI antigens and TD antigens. In the next video, we'll cover more in detail the interaction between the B cell and the helper T cell.